Good morning. We will start the today class. Now, in the last class in the tissue chapter, I discussed about the different name of the four different types of the tissue. And the first tissue, the epithelial tissue. In the epithelial tissue, we categorized epithelial tissue into the according to the cover and lining and glandular epithelium. In the cover and lining, then we studied about the according to arrangement of the layer, according to arrangement of the sheath, and then second part, the glandular epithelium will be. Now we will start. So before starting the glandular epithelium, once again, I will tell you what will be the objective to learning that this tissue and the learning outcomes. So similarly, by studying this topic, you will understand the gross morphology and the structures and their physiology of the various tissue present in the organs and in the human body, in the human system. You can describe the various homeostasis mechanisms and their imbalances. You can identify the different type of the tissue and organs of the different system of the human body. And you can well explain how the different type of the tissue in one organ can coordinate for performing their functions. The learning outcome of this topic will be, you can identify the tissue and their types and their role and their function in the human body. You can identify the four different type of the tissue and their characteristics, how they form, how they function, as well as how these enable the information processing and control the muscle and glandular activities. So you will learn all these things in the today class. Now we will start the topic glandular epithelium. A gland is a structure made up of the one or more cell modified to synthesize and secrete the chemical substance. A gland is a structure made up of one or more cells. A gland that is mainly composed of the one or more cells, and it will help to synthesize and secrete the chemical substance. And the main function of the gland is the secretion. They will release some chemical substance. And the most of the group of the gland, if you see, many gland will made up of the epithelial cells. So the gland can be classified as an endocrine gland or exocrine gland. If you're talking about the glandular epithelium, you will see the glands are composed of the epithelial cell. And the gland having the major function is to secrete, to release the chemical substance. Now, gland can be again classified into the endocrine and exocrine. Endocrine is a ductless gland that releases the secretion directly into the surrounding tissue and fluids. Endocrine. Crine means secretion, inside secretion. Similarly, the second one is the exocrine gland, whose secretion have leave through the duct that opens directly or indirectly to the external environment. So this gland can be categorized into the endocrine gland, ductless gland. They secrete the chemical substance directly into the bloodstream or into the tissue. Second will be the exocrine gland, is the ductful gland. They will secrete their secretion through the duct. Now, exocrine glands release their content through a duct that leads to the epithelial surface. Mucus, perspiration, like we're talking about the mucus. You can see there is the mucus will secrete it through the ducts. Perspiration, sweating will be secreted through the ducts. Digestive enzyme secreted through the ducts. Saliva, if you remember, in the chapter of the digestive system, I taught you about the different salivary gland and their duct, like the mandible having the mandibular duct, submandible having submandibular duct, lingual having the lingual duct. So these ducts are secreted their secretion into the oral cavity. So it will act as an exocrine gland. Breast milk having the ducts. So these all are the example of the secretion from exocrine glands. And these are discharged their substance through a duct. Now endocrine, they ultimately secrete their product into the blood system like the hormones. Hormones are always secreted without the ducts. There is no need to duct to secrete to transport the hormones. Hormone just released, just secrete and goes into the bloodstream. So hormones are the chemicals that regulate the various physiological activities like pituitary gland, thyroid gland, adrenal glands, and are all the endocrine glands. They are secreted the hormone directly into the bloodstream without the help of any duct. They are ductless. Now the classification of the exocrine gland. Now exocrine glands, that means the ductful gland, can be classified according to their structure and shape of the secretory portion. According to the structure, according to the shape, this can be classified. According to structure, it can be classified into the unicellular gland. According to structure, it can be classified unicellular, just like in the first one, glandular epithelium we are talking about is the second one. The first one was the lining and covering of the epithelium. And it is also classified according to the structural classification, arrangement of the layer, simple, stratified, pseudo-stratified. Similarly here, the glands can be categorized, this exocrine glands can be categorized, can be classified according to the structure and shape. So according to structure, it can be unicellular glands. So those glands having the single celled. Unicellular glands कौन से cell होते हैं? वो cell होते हैं जो सिर्फ एक cell से बने होते हैं, single cell से बने होते हैं. इसका example है goblet cell in the respiratory, GIT and genitourinary system. So goblet cell are the single celled gland. Multicellular glands, those cells made up of composed of more than one cell. It can be found in the several different forms. By looking into the secretory portion, exocrine glands are grouped into the tubular glands. If the secretory portion of gland is tubules, it is a shape. We are talking about the according to the shape. So it can be tubular, tubule-like structure. It can be achenar glands, that is the flask-like structure. Tubulo-achenar, if it contains the both tubule and the flask shape secretory portion, it will be called a tubulo-achenar. So either it will be tubular gland, which contains the tubule like the ducts or secretory portion, achenar, which having the flask-like secretory portion, and tubulo-achenar are both. So furthermore, if the ducts does not branch, it is referred as a simple gland, and if it is branched, it is compound gland. So if the glands are branched, it will be called compound gland, and if it is not branched, it will be called the simple gland. By combining the shape of the secretory portion with the degree of the branching of the duct, exocrine glands are classified again into the unicellular, multicellular and compounds. Unicellular is composed of the one cell. Multicellular is composed of the several other cells. Simple tubular, branchial tubular, colloid tubular, and achenar branched achenar. Compound is there, that means having the branched glands, tubular, achenar, and tubule achenar. Now, after these glandular epithelium, you can see there's a different type of the secretion is there that will be secreted through these glands. These are the glands that is only important primary function is the secretion. Now there's a different type of the secretion is there. in which merocrine secretion is the most common type of exocrine secretion, merocrine. This secretion are enclosed in the vessels that move to the apical surface of the cell, where the contents are released by the exocytosis. So merocrine secretion are the most popular and most common secretion in which there will be a vesicles. In the vesicle, there is a substance will be filled, secretory substance, and then vesicle will move to the apical surface of the cell. Okay, and when it will reach to the apical surface of the cell, it will release the contents by the exocytosis. For example, watery mucus containing the glycoprotein mucin, a lubricant that offers the some pathogen protection, is merocrine secretion. The eccrine glands that produce and secrete the sweat are another example for this merocrine secretion. Another will be the apocrine secretion. In apocrine secretion, accumulate near the apical portion of the cell. That portion of the cell and its secretory content is pinched off from the cell and are released. The sweat gland of armpit are the classified as an apocrine gland. So merocrine secretion and apocrine secretion have a little difference. In the merocrine secretion, a vesicle containing the substance is pushed as the apical surface and then it will release their content. But in the apocrine secretions, the substance are accumulated near the apical portion, and the portion of the cell with the secretory substance is pinched off. That means dissociate from the cells and released. Both merocrine and apocrine glands continue to produce and secrete their content with the little damage caused to the cell, because the nucleus and Golgi regions remains intact after the secretion. In contrast, the process of holocrine secretion, two secretion we understand, merocrine secretion and apocrine secretion, or another one is the holocrine secretion. Holocrine secretion will involve the disruption and the rupture of the entire gland cell, while in the merocrine secretion, only the outer cell is burst and the content is released. In apocrine secretion, the parts of the cell are pinched off, but in the holocrine secretion, entire gland is going to rupture. The cell accumulates its secretory products and release them only when it bursts. New gland cell differentiate from cell in the surrounding tissue to replace those lost by secretion. The sebaceous gland that produce the oil on the skin and the hair, or the holocrine gland. The holocrine gland's example, kaun sa ho jayenge? Sebaceous gland that will produce the oil on the skin and the hair. Now you can see here, the first one is the merocrine secretion, where there is a vesicle filled with the substance going on the apical surface and released. Apocrine secretion, where the substance will accumulate it at the apical surface and then the portion of the cell is pinched off with the secretion and released. Holocrine secretion, the whole cells are going to rupture. So mature cell dies and becomes secretory products. Now, glands are also named after the product they produced, because we know when they produce the some substance and they can be named the same things, it will be quite easy to understand. So the serous gland produce the watery blood plasma like secretion rich in the enzyme such as the alpha amylase, whereas the mucus gland release the watery to the viscous product rich in the glycoprotein mucin. Both serous and mucus glands are common in the salivary gland of the mouth. Mixed exocrine glands contain the both serous and mucus gland and release the both type of the secretion. Now the first tissue, epithelial tissue, is over. Now second tissue is going to start, that will be called the connective tissue. Connective tissue, connective tissue of the body are classified into the embryonic connective tissue and adult connective tissue. So you can categorize the connective tissue, you can classify the connective tissue in a two way. First one is the embryonic connective tissue and adult connective tissue. Second one, embryonic connective tissue contains the mesenchyma and the mucous connective tissue. The embryonic connective tissue will contains the mesenchyme and the mucous connective tissue. So mesenchyme is the tissue from which all other connective tissue eventually arises. So mesenchyme tissue is the those tissue from which other connective tissue will going to arise. It is located beneath the skin and along the developing bone of the embryo. The first connective tissue to develop in the embryo is mesenchyme. So sabse pehla tissue jo embryo mein develop ho raha hai, connective tissue develop ho raha hai, that will be called the mesenchyma. And the cluster of the mesenchyma cell are scattered throughout the adult tissue and supply the cell needed for replacement and repair after a connective tissue injury. Mucus, or you can say the Wharton jelly. A connective tissue is found primarily in the fetus and located in the umbilical cord of the fetus where it is supported the cords. Yeah. A second type of the embryonic connective tissue found in the umbilical cord called mucous connective tissue or Wharton jelly. This tissue is no longer present after the birth, leaving only scattered mesenchymal cells throughout the body. The second type of embryonic tissue hai, that will form in the umbilical cord. This tissue is no longer present after the birth and leaving only the scattered mesenchymal cells. Second will be adult connective tissue. It is differentiated from the mesenchyma and does not change after the birth. As like the mesenchyma is changed after the birth, this connective tissue, adult connective tissue, is differentiated from the mesenchyma and it will be not changed after the birth. So this connective tissue, adult connective tissue, composes connective tissue proper, cartilage, osseous and vascular, that is blood tissue. So connective tissue proper, the first one, has a more or less fluid intercellular myriads and fibroblast. The various form of the connective tissue proper are the loose connective tissue, yeah, you can say the areolar connective tissue, which are widely distributed and consist of collagenic elastic and the reticular fiber and several cells embedded in the semi-fluid intercellular substance, and it will support the tissues, organ, blood vessels and nerves. It also forms the subcutaneous layer, superficial, physica and hypodermis. Second will be like adipose tissue. The first one is the areolar connective tissue. Second will be adipose tissue. It is a subcutaneous layer below the skin. Adipose tissue is a subcutaneous layer below the skin and is specialized for fat storage. So it will be found where there is a loose connective tissue, and it is common around the kidney, at the base and on the surface of the heart, in the marrow of the long bone, as a padding and around the joints, and behind the eyeball. So it will help to store it in the fat. Third will be the dense or collagenous connective tissue. Fibers are closely packed than in close connective tissue. If you're talking about the dense connective tissue, that means they are the closely packed. And fibers are closely packed in. Exist in the areas where tension are exerted in various directions. And this dense connective tissue will be located in the those body parts where the more tension are exerted. This occurs in the most fascia, like the deeper region of the dermis, periostem of the bone and the membrane capsules. In other areas, dense connective tissue adopted the tension in one direction and fibers have parallel arrangements like the tendons and ligaments. So dense connective tissue provide the support and protection and connect the muscles to the bone. So the, you know, the tendons connecting the muscles to the bone, and when we walk there is a putting the great strength, the pressure exerted on these tendons, and these ligaments which connected the bone to bone. Next will be elastic connective tissue. As the name elastic, it has some elasticity property. So it's possibly freely branching elastic fibers. They stretch and snap the back into the original space. If you see it with property, it will be stretch and snap back into the origin's shape. They are component of wall of artery. Now where it will be located in the wall of the artery, trachea, bronchial tubes, and the lungs. It also helping in the form of the vocal cords. The elastic connective tissues allow the stretching and provide support and suspension. So with the elastic property, the arteries can be expanded, the trachea can be expanded, the lungs and tubes can be expanded, so it having the elastic connective tissue. Next one will be the reticular connective tissue. The lattice of the interwoven threads that branch freely, forming, connecting, and supporting the framework. It helps to form a delicate supporting stroma for many organs, including the liver, spleen, and lymph nodes. It also helps to bind together the fiber of the smooth muscle. So reticulated tissue will act as an interwoven thread that will connect into each other. Second, cartilage. Unlike the other connective tissue, cartilages have no blood vessel and nerves. Like the other tissue, cartilages have no blood vessels and nerves. It consists of a dense network of collagenous fiber and elastic fiber that will firmly embedded in the chondroitin sulfate. So like the other tissue, जैसे कि दूसरे टिश्यूज में होते हैं ब्लड वेसल्स हैं नर्व्स हैं, कार्टिलेज टिश्यू में नहीं होंगे. इसमें कोलेजन फाइबर्स होंगे, इलास्टिक फाइबर्स होंगे, जो कि कोंड्राइटिन सल्फेट्स में पड़े हुए होंगे, जुड़े हुए होंगे या एम्बेडेड होंगे, धसे हुए होंगे. द स्ट्रेंथ इज बिकॉज ऑफ कोलेजन फाइबर. द सेल ऑफ मैच्योर कार्टिलेज आर कॉल्ड द कोंड्रोसाइट्स. So if there is a mature cartilage, are called the chondrocytes. So chondrocytes are those cells that having the mature cartilage. The surface of a cartilage is surrounded by an irregular arranged dense connective tissue called the perichondrium. So cartilage surface is surrounded by the irregularly arranged dense connective tissue. This ko bolte hain perichondrium. Cartilages are classified into the hyaline, fibro, and elastic cartilages. So, this cartilage can be classified again into the hyaline cartilage, fibro cartilage, and elastic cartilage. Fibro cartilage is there. They are found at the symphysis pubis in the intervertebral disc and knee, providing the support and protection. Fibro cartilage, hyaline cartilage. Called the crystal, most abundant, blue-white in color, and able to bear the weight found at the joints over the long bones as articular cartilage and form the costal cartilage. It also forms the nose, larynx, trachea, bronchi, and the bronchial tubes. It forms the embryonic skeleton, reinforce the respiration, add in the free movement of the joints, and assist, and it will help to rib cage to move during the breathing. So that all will be the hyaline cartilage. Elastic cartilage will be. Elastic cartilage, the chondrocytes are located in the thread-like network of elastic fiber. So the elastic cartilage provide the strength and elasticity and maintain the shape of certain organs like the epiglottis, larynx, external part of the ear, and the eustachian tube. So these all the made up of the elastic cartilage. Then third one will be the osseous tissue. Yeah, you can say the bone tissue. The matured bone cell that will be called the osteocyte, embedded in the intercellular substance consisting the mineral salt, calcium phosphate honge, calcium carbonates honge, with the collagenous fibers. So the osseous tissue, the bone tissue, together with cartilage and joints, it comprises the skeletal system. Skeletal system is not only with bone, but is the bone together with the cartilage and the joints. And when the cartilage and joints are combined together with the bone, then it will be formed the skeleton system. Next will be the vascular tissue, or you can say the blood tissue. Now the blood tissue, it is a liquid connective tissue. It contains the intercellular substance plasma. Plasma is a straw colored liquid, consists the water and dissolved material. The formed element of the blood are erythrocyte. Now you will see the blood having the two components, formed element and the plasma. Formed element having the RBC, WBC and platelets, like the erythrocytes, leukocytes and thrombocytes. And the fibrous characteristics of the blood revealed when it clotted. So it is another type of the tissue that is called the vascular tissue or blood tissue. After the connective tissue, third tissue will be we have a muscular tissue. So you know, we are going for the muscular tissue. Muscular tissue is there. Now, muscle tissue consists of highly specialized cell, which provides the motion and maintenance of the posture. Classification of muscle tissue is made up by the structures and function. Muscle tissue are grouped into the skeletal, cardiac and smooth muscle. If you see the structure, the muscular tissue is highly specialized cell that will be helping in the motion, jo hamare movement mein help karti hai, jo hamare body ke postures mein help karti hai, postures maintain karne mein help karti hai. And it can be classified according to the structure and function. So skeletal muscle, cardiac muscle and smooth muscle. You will see the first one is the skeletal muscle. The tissue are attached to the bones. It is voluntary, cylindrical, multinucleated and striated. Skeletal muscle. So skeletal muscle are those tissue that are attached to the bones. And it is voluntary. We can move according to our desire, like the muscles in the mouth. When we want to chew, then we chew. When we want to swallow, then we will swallow the foods. So chewing and swallowing is depends upon our desire, and it will also helping. So skeletal muscle involved in these cases are the example. Cardiac muscle tissue, it forms the wall of the heart and it is involuntary. So those muscles tissue that forms the heart surrounding walls, and it is involuntary, it is not dependent upon our desire, it is involuntary and uninucleated and striated. Similarly, you will see the smooth muscle tissue that will located in the wall of the hollow internal structure, like the blood vessel, stomach, intestine, urinary bladder, and it is involuntary also, non-striated. Like the blood vessels, you cannot dilate, you cannot constrict the blood vessel according to your desire. So smooth muscle are involved in these cases. Now there is a comparison of the structure and properties of the muscular tissue and types. You will see the first one is the skeletal muscles. Histology, long cylindrical fibers, striated honge, many peripherally located nuclei. Functions, voluntary movements honge, produce the heat and protect the organs. Location, attached to the bones and around the entrance point to body, example mouth and anus. Cardiac ki baat kare, cardiac muscles ki baat kare, it will be short, branched, striated, single central nucleus. It will be contract to pump the blood. Cardiac muscle cells are just surrounding the heart, the wall of the heart, and it will, when it will be contract, okay, it will causes the heart to pump the blood. So cardiac muscles will help to contract the pump blood. Location is the heart. Smooth muscles ki baat karein, short honge, spindle shaped honge, नो एविडेंट स्ट्राइशंस होंगे, सिंगल न्यूक्लियस इन ईच फाइबर. फंक्शंस की बात करें, इन्वॉल्वेंट्री मूवमेंट है, मूव्स द फूड, इन्वॉल्वेंट्री कंट्रोल ऑफ रिस्पायरेशन, मूव्स द सिक्रीशन, रेगुलेट द फ्लो ऑफ ब्लड इन आर्टरीज बाय द कॉन्ट्रैक्शन. सो दीज ऑल फंक्शंस कैरिड आउट बाय द स्मूथ मसल्स एंड दीज आर इन्वॉल्वेंट्री. इट इज डज नॉट डिपेंड अपॉन अवर डिजायर. लोकेशन की बात करेंगे तो वॉल ऑफ द मेजर ऑर्गन्स एंड द पासेज वे. नाउ द फोर्थ टिश्यू दैट इज कॉल्ड द नर्वस टिश्यू. Nervous tissue contains the two principal cell types. These are called the neurons and neuroglia. If you remember in the central nervous system, I taught you about the nervous tissue. So nervous tissue is having the two principal cell types. One is the neurons and second is the neuroglia. Neurons are the nerve cells sensitive to the various stimuli. It converts the stimuli to the nerve impulse. The neurons are the structural and functional unit of the nervous system. It contains three basic portions. These are the cell body, axon, and dendrites. And neuroglia are the cells that protect the nerves and support the neurons. Then you will understand, when we are talking about the neurons, neurons are the nerve cell that will be stimulated by the stimuli. So there are the various stimuli that can be stimulated. It could be external stimulus, it could be internal stimulus. So either it could be internal, either it could be external. So these stimulus, when giving the stimulation to the nerve cells, and nerve cell is going to active. So in this process, there is a three things. First one is the receptor. Second is the motor center. And the third one is the integration, or the, you can say, the effector organs. So if nerves cell are receiving the signal from the receptor, this will receptor will send the signals toward the motor center, then motor center will command them by the effector organs. And these neurons will contain the three basic portion that we're having: the cell body, dendrites, and axon. A cell body having some extension part in their outer cell membrane. That extension part of the cell membrane, outer cell membrane, will call the dendrites. There is a many dendrites. So these dendrites will receive a signals from the another cell, another neurons, and just transmit the signals, transmit the information, transmit the nerve impulses towards the cell body. Then from the cell body, this signal will transmit towards the axon. Now at the terminal points, its axon hillock is there, from where the this signal's transmission is going to further into the axon. And that axon is myelinated with the myelin sheath that is composed of the Schwann cell. And the gap between these myelinated sheath is called the node of Ranvier. That will help to speed the transmission, the faster the transmission. So the transmission will be faster. And at the end, these signals are reaches at the nerve terminal through the axon. So dendrites receive the signal sending towards the cell body. From the cell body, signals goes to the axon. And from the axon, it will be reaches to the nerve terminals. And these terminals contain the several buds. Terminal buds, and these buds having the vesicles, and these vesicles will contains the neurotransmitter. So when the stimulus reaches to the nerve terminals into the buds, these stimulus will causes the release of the transmitter. So transmitter will be released at the gap between the two neurons or between the neurons and cell. So that gap is called the synaptic cleft. So synaptic cleft is a gap between the two neurons or between the neurons and cell. After that, when the neurotransmitter will be released, and this neurotransmitter is going to bind with the next receptor of the targeted cells or effector cells. If it is a effector cells, then the then the neurotransmitter will goes and bite with the receptor and produce the action. Otherwise, if it is another neurons, then these neurotransmitter will goes and bind with the another neurons dendrites, dendrite receiving the signals, and the same process is going to happen again. So these are the neurons. Second will be the neuroglia. Neuroglia are the cells that protect, nourish and support the neurons. So neuroglia wo cells hai jo neurons ko support kar rahi hai, neuron ko protect kar rahi hai, neuron ka nourishment kar rahi hai. So these are the two cells that will involve the nervous tissue. Now you can see the images are here. The cell body of a neuron, also called the soma body, contains the nucleus and the mitochondria. The dendrite transfer the nerve impulse to the soma. That means dendrite receiving the signals and transfer the impulses, nerve impulses, to the central body or soma. The axon carries the action potential away to the another excitable cell. So you can see the structure of the neurons here. They have the nucleus, they have the dendrites, they have the mitochondria and the microtubules. Contact with the other cells and axon is there. There is another structure. There is another structure of the neurons. So you can see there is a dendrites. Direction of impulse is there, so dendrites are receiving the signals, and in the red color you can see the impulses as going to the travel through the cell body, then through the axon and reaching to the nerve terminal, so it will produce the their further action. Now we have some number of the quizzes there. So this quiz will help you to make it clear about this topic. Question number first. Which of the following is not an example of the cell? Which of the following is not an example of the cell? Now we have to understand, इसमें से ऐसा कौन सा है जो सेल का एग्जाम्पल नहीं है? मैक्रोफेजेस, लाइसोसोम, प्लाज्मोसाइट्स और कोंड्रोब्लास्ट. सो आंसर बी कोंड्रोब्लास्ट, सॉरी आंसर बी लाइसोसोम. लाइसोसोम इज नॉट एन एग्जाम्पल ऑफ द सेल. मैक्रोफेजेस आर द सेल, प्लाज्मोसाइट्स एंड कोंड्रोब्लास्ट. Next question, which cell organelles contain an acidic environment capable of digesting a wide variety of molecules? कौन सा cell organelles है जो acidic environment contains कर रहा है और वो capable है digest a wide variety of molecules, molecules को digest कर सकता है? Is lysosome, ribosome, gentrosome or Golgi complex? Here it's a lysosome. Lysosome having the acidic environment and it can be digest the different type of the molecules. Next question, which form of transport through the plasma membrane requires the expenditure of energy by the cell? So you will see there, which form of the plasma membrane, okay, which form of transport through the plasma membrane require plasma membrane ke through kaun sa transport possible hai jo require kar rahe hain the expenditure of energy by the cell, kaun se ho sakte hain? It is a facilitated diffusion. Or you can say osmosis. Either you can say active transport or diffusion. कौन सा हो सकता है? सो विच फॉर्म ऑफ ट्रांसपोर्ट, कौन सा इसमें से ट्रांसपोर्ट प्रोसेस है, मैकेनिज्म है जिसको एनर्जी की रिक्वायरमेंट है, एनर्जी की डिमांड है? इट कुड बी फैसिलिटेटेड डिफ्यूजन. इन द डिफ्यूजन दे समवन इज द फैसिलिटेटर, समवन इज हेल्पिंग देम. ऑस्मोसिस दैट इज डिपेंड अपॉन द कंसंट्रेशन ग्रेडियंट. डिफ्यूजन दैट इज ऑल्सो डिपेंड्स अपॉन द कंसंट्रेशन एंड थ्रू द प्लाज्मा मेम्ब्रेन्स. एक्टिव ट्रांसपोर्ट इज देयर. एक्टिव ट्रांसपोर्ट नीड्स द एनर्जी, रिक्वायर्स द एनर्जी to transport through the plasma membrane. So yes, correct answer is C. Which of the following is not made predominantly from epithelial tissue? इसमें ऐसा कौन सा है जो epithelial tissue से predominantly made नहीं है? In the dermis, exocrine, endocrine or endothelium? Of the blood vessel in the dermis is there. What tissue has cells that are closely packed and that have one surface attached to a basement membrane and the other surface to the space? Aisa kaun sa specific tissue hai jo closely packed hai, that are closely packed और जिसका एक सरफेस बेसमेंट मेम्ब्रेन से अटैच्ड है एंड अदर इन द फ्री स्पेस? इट इज एपिथेलियल टिश्यू, मस्कुलर टिश्यू, कनेक्टिव टिश्यू, नर्वस टिश्यू? इट कुड बी एपिथेलियल टिश्यू. नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन, विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग इज नॉट एन एग्जांपल ऑफ द कनेक्टिव टिश्यू? इसमें से ऐसा कौन सा जो कनेक्टिव टिश्यू का एग्जांपल नहीं है? वी हर्ड अबाउट द लॉट्स ऑफ द थिंग अबाउट द कनेक्टिव टिश्यू. ब्लड इज अ कनेक्टिव टिश्यू, बोन इज अ कनेक्टिव टिश्यू, tendon is a connective tissue, but epidermis is not. Epidermis is a epithelial tissue. So answer D is correct. Now next question will be the, choose the tissue below that is one of the four primary type of the body tissue: epithelial tissue, connective tissue, muscle tissue and nervous tissue. ये चार प्राइमरी टाइप के टिश्यू हैं, इनमें से कौन सा ऐसा है एक टिश्यू इसमें मेंशन है? दैट विल बी बी, एपिथेलियल टिश्यू. विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग इज नॉट पार्ट ऑफ द प्लाज्मा मेम्ब्रेन ऑफ सेल? सो विच वन ऑफ द फॉलोइंग हियर प्लाज्मा मेम्ब्रेन का पार्ट नहीं है? फॉस्फोलिपिड इज अ पार्ट ऑफ द प्लाज्मा मेम्ब्रेन, ग्लाइकोप्रोटीन इज अ पार्ट ऑफ प्लाज्मा मेम्ब्रेन, क्रोमेटिन इज अ पार्ट ऑफ प्लाज्मा मेम्ब्रेन. इज इट करेक्ट? नो, क्रोमेटिन इज नॉट अ पार्ट ऑफ प्लाज्मा मेम्ब्रेन. क्रोमेटिन थ्रेड इट इज अ पार्ट ऑफ द सेल. ये सेल्स में पाए जाएंगे, सेल्स में होंगे बट प्लाज्मा मेम्ब्रेन में नहीं होंगे. कोलेस्ट्रॉल इज इट स्टिल? सो आंसर सी इज करेक्ट. एडिपोसाइट्स आर फाउंड इन विच टाइप ऑफ टिश्यू? एडिपोसाइट्स आर फाउंड इन विच टाइप ऑफ द टिश्यू? ऐसे कौन से टिश्यू है जिसमें एडिपोसाइट्स होंगे? मसल टिश्यू, एपिथेलियल टिश्यू, नर्वस टिश्यू, कनेक्टिव टिश्यू? सो एडिपोसाइट्स आर फाउंड इन विच टाइप ऑफ द टिश्यू? सो एडिपोसाइट्स विल बी प्रेजेंट इन द कनेक्टिव टिश्यू. Last question. What is the difference between the simple squamous cell and simple columnar cell? Simple squamous cell or simple columnar cells mein kya difference hoga? Simple means one layer cell hai. Squamous hai matlab flat hoga. Columnar hai matlab cylindrical honge, columns honge. To squamous cells are flattened while columnar cells are taller than they are wide. मतलब ये सही लग रहा है क्योंकि squamous flat होते हैं and columnar cylindricals होते हैं, taller होते हैं. Simple squamous cells are one layer thick while simple columnar cells are several layer thick. It is incorrect. Simple है तो several layer तो होगा ही नहीं. Not possible to having the several layers. See, simple squamous cells are epithelial tissue, while simple columnar cells are connective tissue. It is also incorrect. These are the epithelial tissue. D. Squamous cells are flattened. Okay, correct. While columnar cells are cuboidal. No, it's not a cuboidal. It's not a cube-like structure. It's a... So answer A is correct. Okay. Now, after these things, you have to, go to the reference book. And in the reference, you will see there is a different reference book is there that will help you. Like the Tortora is there. And Robinson Cotron is there. Bill Melinda is there. So here I mentioned the several books are there. You can see there. These are the Tortora, Gerard. There's the Principal Anatomy and Physiology. Bell Melinda and the Robinson and Cotron. These are the most tremendous and most excellent book. One is the Rawson and Wilson is also there. You can go through the Rawson and Wilson. We have some other wavelength is there. So you can also help to through these wavelengths. Okay. So now it is clear to everyone that in the tissue, we have the four primary tissue: epithelial tissue, connective tissue, muscle tissue, and nervous tissue. First, we divided the epithelial tissue into the different parts like the lining epithelium and the glandular epithelium. In the lining epithelium, again divided into arrangement of layer and arrangement of cell, that is simple, stratified, and pseudo-stratified. And then simple, you can say, columnar is there, squamous is there, okay? Glandular epithelium is also there, that having the description of the glands, that will be the endocrine and exocrine glands. Then we have second is the connective tissue, in which you have the same, the several connective tissue, like the dense connective tissue, areolar connective tissue. Okay, for the several types of connective tissue you learn. After the connective tissue, then you go to the muscle tissue, and you have seen the cardiac muscle, smooth muscles, skeletal muscles. And then the nervous tissue, in which you learn about the neurons and neuroglia. So now tissue chapter is finished. We are here going to close the tissue. Then we will meet again in the next class with some new topic, with some new energy. Till then, thank you.